We're going back to 1959. Mikhail Tal versus Rashid Nezhmetdinov, e4, c5, Sicilian defense. Knight f3, e6, d4, c, d, knight takes d4, a6. Tal is delaying the development of the kingside. This idea may give him flexibility. In doing so, he made a pawn advance that was nearly identical to the Sicilian defense, which was extremely important both for attack and development, as well as taking measures. All right, while Nezhmetdinov continued his development with c3, Tal's response was queen c7. Since it's blocking the e5, he'll be able to develop his knight comfortably now. Bishop d3, knight c6. Tal pointed out his opponent's previous move and demanded the undefended knight. After knight takes c6, one option here is to weaken your opponent's queenside pawn structure. However, in return, your opponent would have more control over the center. For this reason, against knight c6, Nezhmetdinov chose to support his knight with bishop e3, and with the knight f6, Tal is also beginning to develop his kingside. I'd like to briefly discuss the significance of the knight c6 and knight f6 move sequences. At some point, your opponent might want to weaken your kingside pawn structure with the bishop g5, and since we usually prefer the kingside castling, this would not be the situation we wanted. But a decision has already been made about this bishop, and you no longer need to worry about the bishop g5. So, because the bishop wouldn't have to rely on the knight's defenses, it would have a lot more development options. Now, after knight f6, kingside castling. Here we see Tal playing in a narrower space. For this reason, the strategy of exchanging pieces with knight d4 would be a very principled approach. In return, however, your opponent would have an excellent central bishop facing both sides of the board. Yes, with bishop c5, you can exchange this bishop to maintain consistency in your price exchange strategy. Nonetheless, you must risk weakening your kingside, or your opponent can accept that exchange. Because of the pawn advances you made after that, the weaknesses in these squares would become apparent throughout the game. So, in e6 structures, the importance of the king's bishop was quite great. On the one hand, we know very well that Tal doesn't like empty positions, and instead of exchanging pieces, we're getting a very aggressive move that we expect from Tal. Knight e5. Of course, the main idea is to take the opponent's bishop. Nezhmetdinov played h3. He blocked the knight g4 and can now gain space with tempo. While Tal continues to gain space from the queen side with b5, now, f4. Of course, Tal was prepared for this advance, knight c4, and he doesn't give his opponent much of a notice. He says you should take this knight. Bishop takes c4, queen takes c4. Guys, one of the demands here is to take the pawn after b4, or you can increase the pressure on the center with the bishop b7 directly. Because the early a6 systems of the Sicilian defense delay kingside development, it allows for the development of a quick queenside and so quick pressure on the opposing center. This way, you don't leave your opponent alone with this beautiful space advantage in the center. Furthermore, it may leave you in the middle. I'm referring to the ideas of, I'm wondering if my opponent will castle on the kingside. Should I devise a strategy for this? Or will he put it off for a long time? May leave you hanging in midair. Of course, you must first defend your center, or those questions will be meaningless. All of the problems we just discussed had one thing in common, the e4 pawn. For this reason, Nezhmetdinov proposes the exchange of the queens with queen d3. Yes, I am aware. It's a phrase we don't often hear in Nezhmetdinov's games, but he had important reasons for doing so. If the queen was exchanged, The e4 pawn would no longer be a problem, but it would also be able to eliminate the weak c-pawn and the semi-open c-line. Against queen d3, Tal is not making this exchange yet, and here he continues with d5. If you can make the d5 move in the Sicilian defense, you're on the right track, because this is the center pawn that gives your opponent a space advantage. So in the future, this center pawn could launch a kingside attack or support this pawn advance. A very valuable pawn that can serve as the piece's mainstay. So exchanging this pawn is considered a success. He's also trying to increase the impact of the long cross bishop. Of course, it would be very dangerous to allow the center to open in this way when we have not yet made a castling. Tal's assurance here is that he can exchange the queen whenever he wants. Against d5, you don't want to close the center because your opponent hasn't castled yet. That's why Nezhmetdinov played e takes d5 move. And now that the situation has become a little dangerous, Tal's exchanging the queens. Queen takes d3, c takes d3, and here is b4, a very important intermediate move. The reason for this was to send the knight from the c3 square away, and when the knight moved to e4, he placed a strong, central knight in the d5 square, and he kept the pawn structure. Bishop to d2 now. Of course, Tal's strategy for entering the endgame must be correct. He has a bishop pair to his advantage. His king is still in the center, and his opponent's pawn structure is much weaker. These are Tal's static advantages. Nezhmetdinov, on the other hand, has a significant developmental advantage. This is Nezhmetdinov's dynamic advantage. So the big question here is whether dynamic advantages or static factors will win out. We can conclude that Nezhmetdinov must act quickly before his opponent closes the development gap. Now, with a5, Tal has provided strong support to his pawn while also opening a beautiful square for the queen's bishop. Rook ac1. Rooks love open lines. Now, with the bishop a6, there's pressure on the weak pawn. Guys, what if I told you here that Nezhmetdinov tried to protect his pawn with rook f3? I don't think any of you would believe that. Yes, Nezhmetdinov does not bother to protect the pawn. What did we say? He needs to hurry, especially when the opposing king is in the center. He plays rook fe1. He sacrificed the pawn. If this pawn sacrifice was accepted, the knight f2 would come with tempo, and then open the e-line, putting a lot of pressure on the f5 advance. So Tal refused to accept the pawn sacrifice, and with the g6, he wants to prevent the opponent from advancing f5 as soon as possible. In chess history, Nezhmetdinov was known as a master who did not back down. Even though he is blocked by two pawns here, he does not give up and continues to play with f5. Of course, I wouldn't even think about taking it with the e-pawn. That would be a bad idea. However, if the g takes f5 move was made, with f5, the knight would be much closer to the opposing area. Well, I forgot to mention it before. Aside from Nezhmetdinov's developmental superiority, his excellent knights in the center stand out immediately. And if you accept this knight's sacrifice here, Knight f6 and then Rook e8. It would be mate in two moves. So against f5, with the Bishop g7 move, it is quite understandable that Tal tried for kingside castling as soon as possible. And it appears that he will be able to do so. Because he demanded the knight with tempo, and if he could perform kingside castling, it would be ideal for Tal. Nezhmetdinov sees this, of course, and immediately proceeds with f6. Because this bishop was so valuable, he took the pawn with knight. And with only one move left, Nezhmetdinov was able to catch the opposing king in the center. Knight d6 and king e7. Yes, Tal's castling was corrupted, but he was still able to complete his development. So, what could go wrong? Sure, Nezhmetdinov moved his knight to the sixth square, but how will the rest of the game play out? He demands the knight. This structure in the center looks pretty solid, doesn't it? However, Nezhmetdinov showed us that this is not really the case, with knight takes f7 sacrifice. You have no better choice but to take this piece. King takes f7 and the rook c7. Of course, to prevent the king's tempo and piece loss, the king g8 is the only option. And here, the knight takes e6 countermove. So, even though he exchanged the queens, Nezhmetdinov makes an excellent mate attack, despite the fact that he lacks a queen. Now he wants a mate in one move. Tal chose to defend it with the knight e8 move. He demanded the rook and defended the mate. When Nezhmetdinov took his rook to d7, this is undoubtedly the most important moment of the game. Normally, a move like bishop c8 deserves to be examined, because being able to exchange one of the pieces that comprise of your opponent's mate attack will greatly relieve you, because Tal has the advantage in terms of material. But against bishop c8, there would be an annoying pin like rook d8. That's why, against rook d7, Tal first plays bishop f6, so that now the bishop can easily prepare the c8 move. Yes, his strategy is correct, but he's losing tactically. Here, Nezhmetdinov continued to play with rook f1. Now, rook takes f6, and then rook g7. He wants to mate. There's also the rook f8 mate threat if you make a mistake. And it would be too late to fix your mistake and revert back, because the other rook would come to the 7th horizontal, and it appears to be a disaster. So against rook f1, Tal had to give the material to avoid being mated. Knight g7, rook takes f6, knight takes e6, rook takes e6. He isn't mated, but he is one pawn behind, and the position is still very bad. Nezhmetdinov has a significant advantage here, such as opposite-colored bishops. If the board has opposite-colored bishops, the attacking side has a significant advantage. This is because there is no way for this bishop to defend these squares around the king, so you appear to be attacking with an extra bishop. After the latest rook takes e6 move, Tal is trying to defend the position, bishop b5, and when the rook moves to c7, there's no time to take the pawn here yet, because Nezhmetdinov would surround the rival king with a bishop h6 and rook f6, and he planned to create a mate pattern with the rook g7. That's why with h5, Tal was trying to block the bishop h6 mate attack. The thing is, unfortunately, the pawn is undefended. Rook takes g6, king f8, bishop h8, king e8, rook e6, followed by king d8 and rook c5. He demands the bishop. Of course, if the pawn was taken again, he would capture the bishop with rook d5. That's why, against rook c5, Tal counterattacked with king d7. Nezhmetdinov demands the bishop again with rook b6. Tal now plays bishop takes d3. Because if his opponent played rook d5, he could launch a counterattack with king c7. That's why, against bishop takes d3, Nezhmetdinov played bishop f4. He says no more king c7, and he really wants to take the bishop with rook d5. Tal suggested the exchange of bishops with rook hf8. Of course, Nezhmetdinov will not exchange the bishops because he wants to mate. We just talked about its importance. That's why he played rook d6. Now, after king e7, rook c7, king e8, and bishop g5, he demanded a mate in one move. After rook f1 check and king h2, Tal countered this with bishop f1. Yes, in this way, he opened the f8 square for his king with tempo by checking. But Tal has left the game to rook h6. I mean, he demands this pawn, but there are even bigger demands. First of all, rook h8 is one of them, and if you immediately withdraw it to f8 to defend the rook, it would result in checkmate with rook e6. Or let's say the a2 pawn is taken, and against that, rook h8, rook f8, rook e7, king d8, and there is mate in one move. That's why Tal has left the game to rook h6. Again, we watched a very nice and instructive game from Nezhmetdinov. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you enjoyed this video, please like, leave a comment, and subscribe to this channel. And click the bell icon to stay updated with my new videos. Hope to see you in the next videos. Take care.